PCOD, also termed as the polycystic ovary disease, is one of the most common problems in today's generation. It affects one out of every 10 Indian women and is now treated as a new gynecological epidemic. But what exactly is this problem? Why is it happening and how it can be treated? All these questions are answered by our today's expert, Dr. Neelu Khanna. She is Senior Consultant and Head of the Department Gynecology and Obstetrics, SGL Super Speciality Hospital. With over 15 years of experience, Dr. Neelu is now an important name in the field of obstetrics and gynecology. She is MBBS, MD and has a fellowship in child and maternal child health. She is also a member of several national societies and committees. So let's get the answer to this important question from Dr. Neelu Khanna.
Good morning, ma'am. How are you?
All well, perfect, Ritika. Nice to see you. I've seen many videos, you know.
Thanks.
Really impressed, and my congratulations for bringing and, you know, highlighting certain health issues which are very important in the day life, you know. So
thank
congratulations.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for connecting with us and giving us your precious time. And you are absolutely going to help our viewers on this very important topic, that's PCOD. So shall we begin with the session, ma'am?
Yeah.
Right. So please first tell our viewers, ma'am, what exactly is PCOD?
See, PCOD, it is a common endocrine disorder, which is characterized by heterogeneous manifestations of anorectic cycles, then hyperandrogenism and polycystic morphology. In simpler terms, we can say that the patient comes to us in the reproductive age group or the adolescent age group with main complaints of menstrual irregularities, abnormalities, number one. Number two, increased hair growth, acne, pigmentation of the face, and on ultrasound, we find a typical, you know, voluminous ovaries, bulky ovaries, with a lot of small follicles. And that is it's a common endocrine disorder. These females also have central adiposity, like they have the most important, they have waist circumferences more. They're obese. And this is the typical presentation of patients. And then other symptoms, like some patients come to us in the OPD with a history of infertility. Okay, they are not able to conceive, and so on. Some of them may be having type 2 diabetes mellitus, some of them have hypertension, and so on. The scenario is a big, huge one, no? Of these, this is like endocrine disorder with multiple facets which present to us.
Right, ma'am. Are there any particular reasons that are responsible for PCOD?
Yes, polycystic ovarian syndrome, it is it has a familial inheritance also. There's polygenic inheritance, in the sense we have some receptors, you know, at the level of the pancreas, the insulin receptors, they are defective. There are certain genes, CYP genes, it's like more scientific actually, which I'm discussing, the CYP genes and many other genes associated, in which the insulin level increases, or else there is a level at the brain, the GnRH pulse frequency is more, some hormones are released in high frequency, the level of luteinizing hormone is more, the level of the male hormones, testosterone, androstenedione, you know, certain hormones are increased. So there is a system of hyperandrogenism state, LH level is increased, and this causes more of the male hormones. With the typical, you know, females, they don't have regular cycles in nutshell, and they have more, you know, increased tendency of having obesity. This is at the level of the genetics. Then comes at the level of the lifestyle. At the level of lifestyle, we have seen that those patients who have more sedentary lifestyle, like we can talk of even the children, you know, these days the children, they have an increased academic performances, their academic burden is so much that they have little physical activities, okay? So once they're lesser physical activities, they tend to put on weight. There's more of binge eating. And as we know, it's very common these days, processed foods are there, easy to get foods, like you have an excess on added drinks and pizzas and, you know, chips and also many things. So this is one, that is lifestyle. Then the diet, and then sleep pattern. So we have seen that the ladies and the teenagers, they are working in the call centers, or they're having, you know, late night shifts they have. So sleep pattern, that also has an effect. So these all things, they contribute to the polycystic ovarian disease or the polycystic ovarian syndrome.
Right, ma'am. And ma'am, is it something kind of a life-threatening problem or a serious problem?
As I told to you, as I spoke earlier, this is an endocrine disorder in which the females will have irregular cycles. They may not have decreased cycle, that means less flow, or else they have delayed cycles. You know, the normal duration is, as we know, already 30-day cycle. It may go to 40, 45, 60 days. They may have amenorrhea, no periods at all. And with the result, once they don't have periods, the lining of the uterus starts increasing, which we call endometrial hyperplasia. This hyperplasia in the long run can lead to endometrial cancer also later stages. At the same time, these patients who come to us, though some of them may be lean PCOS, but some of them have phenotypically, they're thick, they're, you know, obese. Such patients, they're vulnerable to have type 2 diabetes mellitus. And this type 2 diabetes mellitus is associated with hyperlipidemia. In the sense, the level of cholesterol is increased, the triglycerides is increased, their LDL level is high, the HDL level is less. HDL is a safe factor for the heart. LDL is a risk factor for the heart. And these patients tend to have atherosclerosis, which causes hypertension. And hypertension, as you know, it paves the way for stroke and cerebrovascular accidents can occur. So in a nutshell, if this is not curtailed or it is not treated well in time, we can have cardiovascular disease at a later stage along with the diabetes. And diabetes will not stop there only. Diabetes has many manifestations on the body, on the eyes, on the brain, on the liver. So it is a complex syndrome which starts from a beginning. And if it is not controlled, it can be a cause of devastation also. So it is definitely, it is serious, complications can occur if it is not controlled in time.
Right, ma'am. And ma'am, can you please tell our viewers about like what kind of treatments are generally followed for this kind of a problem?
Okay. See, polycystic ovarian syndrome cannot be cured. However, we can have a control or check on the progression of the polycystic ovarian syndrome. As I spoke to you, it is a syndrome complex which involves the cosmetology also, the gynecology also, and the endocrinology also. So whenever we see a patient, we have to see what kind of presentation the patient is coming to us. So we have different phenotypes of polycystic, broadly speaking, there are four phenotypes, which I will not be discussing on this platform because that is not important. So we will talk about a nutshell in a small, precise manner we will be discussing. If the patient is coming to us with menstrual disorders, that means she is not having regular cycles, she is young, because we know that if she does not get the periods, there's a risk of endometrial hyperplasia later in life, then we can put her on hormones for regulation of the periods. At the same time, we have to assess whether she is thin and lean or she is obese PCOS. If she is obese PCOS, we have to consult a dietitian, we have to check her BMI, we have to check her fasting sugars, fasting insulin levels, and accordingly, we have to give her a diet plan. Now, you say, what is a diet plan? In the diet plan of the PCOS, the ratio of the carbohydrate, protein, and the fats should be in the ratio of 55, 35, and 10. Because we want that the energy source should be less. She should take less of, you know, these fried food, ghee, oils, less of added drinks, and less of these cheese and all dairy products. And we should stress more on nuts, more on oats, and more on, you know, Indian food is good actually. If you take oil, sarson ka tel, that is fine. Dal, roti, sabji, that is fine. But we don't want processed food to be taken, number one. And small meals, frequent meals, and a heavy voluminous meal, that is preferred. Okay. And fresh green vegetables, tomatoes, which has got light cupine, that is quite, you know, with watery, like cucumber also, the water content is more. So these things are what we prefer in the day-to-day practice. That is for the diet, number one. Number two, we have to see on the lifestyle modification. We tell them that they have to, you know, burn their energy, burn their fats. So they need to have a proper regular outdoor activities. Like they can go for, you know, walk also, brisk walking, not a simple walk. It has to be brisk walk for at least 20 minutes to 30 minutes in a day, in the morning or evening, whatever time they're able to find, okay? Or else they can do some aerobic exercises, cardio exercises, okay? Number three, they can do cycling, which is, you know, anybody can do it. Cycling, jogging, swimming. So there's so many activities they can perform so that they can fight this fat. Number three, this is about the lifestyle modification. Number three is stress. It has been seen that these obese females, when you are obese, you tend to have a low self-esteem. They have more of anxiety, more depressed. So appearance does make a difference, you know, it really makes a difference for females at least, huh? So once they lose their fat, their esteem definitely improves. So we put the patient on pills, the patient have regular cycles, we do the lifestyle modification number two, and if the patient has cosmetic, she comes to with us cosmetic, you know, problems, like she has increased facial hair, then we have to stick to that also, because these patients, they have distribution of the hair that is post terminal hair, more of male pattern type of hair there. That's like sharp, picky, not the soft, fine hair, downy hair right. that Indians have. So for that, simple procedures like they may go for waxing, bleaching, plucking, and so on. Okay, that is a simpler, but they're not permanent methods. They may go for the laser treatment. Number three, if we have to decrease the hair growth, we have some topical preparations for the hair also, and we put them on spironolactone. There's so many medicines, spironolactone, ciprofloxacin, propranolol, so on, which we see, which we have to give, or topical applications. Okay, that is for the hair growth. And when we put them even on these hormones, we have found that they do, you know, improve considerably with the hormones also, because of regularization of periods, the level of androgens decreases and they show a substantial improvement. That is one. Then we have the patients who are coming to us with type 2 diabetes mellitus or hyperinsulinemia. In these, we have some other molecules which we give, like we have the metformin, we have inositol groups of medicines which we give to try to control the level of sugars. And in the same way, we have hyperlipidemia, those who have more of fats in the body. For that, we have the statins and so many medicines. So every aspect of PCOS is dealt separately. At the same time, we have to see if the patient is coming to her, what is a sleep pattern? So we have to focus on each and every variable. That is how we are able to manage and take control and take charge of polycystic ovarian syndrome in any female. We prefer almost 6 to 8 hours. And if it is like if the patient has time, 6 to 9 hours would be better for night sleep. Daytime naps are not allowed. They are not recommended, because those females will say ki raat ko neend puri nahi hui, chalo koi nahi, I'll take rest in the day. And after lunch, you know, they have those naps. They've been shown in studies, they've proven they have increased the weight of the females. So night pattern is very important. Night is meant for sleeping actually, not for waking. Okay. And that is like, as the saying goes, early to bed, early to rise, definitely that really helps. So one has to have a pattern, schedule, and binge eating is to be avoided. Definitely then we can find some cure for PCOS. A message for the patients who are having PCOS is one, if you have PCOS, you should meet your gynecologist. We can curtail it, because if we do not curtail it now, it may progress and a person may land up in a multitude of problems. It is very easy to take care of PCOS, lifestyle modification, the small, you know, changes here and there. Don't be stressed, number one. Have a proper healthy routine of food, diet, sleep. I think with these things, there should be definitely improvement. And physical inactivity is the main reason, you know, which increases the PCOS. So lifestyle modification can help it definitely, and we can take charge of PCOS. We can, you know, curtail it, prevent its progression.